You know those videos that just have an intro that kind of rips the band-aid off immediately? Well, here goes. Hi, I'm trans. Could have just left it at that, I guess. But yeah, I've known I've been non-binary for a while, but recently it's become clearer to me that who I am is a more distinct feeling that I want to actively move into a body that better represents who I am. I know announcements like this can kind of come out of the blue, and that's usually the nature of them, taking enough time to build up confidence and a support network to finally be upfront about it all. And if you're wondering why I have this mask and hood, it's because of a certain amount of anxiety and facial dysphoria and stuff like that. So, despite this being news to others, it's obviously not a new feeling to me. It's something I've known about for some time, and I kind of guess I had more clues about it going back further than I realized. Not all of these are definitive signs of being trans, by the way. It varies completely from person to person, but these stuck out to me in my own feelings and memories. Nor is being non-binary a stepping stone to being trans. It's an identity all in itself. Not all non-binary people are trans, and nor are all trans people non-binary at some point. I always like female characters, to the point where my friends and I, when we'd do action roleplay games in primary school, especially stuff like Bucky O'Hare, that was cool. I'd want to be Jenny or her cousin, who I think was called Felicia. I don't really remember. Most of the male character archetypes I saw on TV or video games just didn't really fit me very well. Even when I wanted to be the same kind of hero as someone like Mendoza from Mysterious Sieges of Gold, I could appreciate his adventure without wanting to be him exactly. It's kind of one of the reasons I felt many stories left me out, even though they were written for boys. It felt like they weren't written for me specifically. It's kind of an odd juxtaposition going through very heavily gendered media, knowing that girl stuff was too girly, as in usually like pink and focused on real world stuff like high school drama and boyfriends, and boy stuff was too. Well, I love the fantasy settings. They were great, but the guys were just not good. And when I say good, they were still heroes, but they're the typical kind of, especially like in sort of 80s, 90s cartoons, they were either sort of sanctimonious main characters, stoic action hero, or arrogant stand-up comic. So, three out of the four turtles for me were an absolute no-go. Donatello was the one true turtle. He was mine. Kind of. Even after that, I had a hard time getting into media for boys, or just kind of boy man culture generally. I went to an all-boys high school and was always jealous of the girls' school uniforms and the subjects they got to study. The boys' school specialised in science and sports, and the girls' school in drama and arts, because of course that's how it works, you know. There was this constant oppressive atmosphere of sexual bravado and a kind of like a cult of apathy towards anything that wasn't sports or comedy or inherently cynical in its own right. Offensive humor was what you were supposed to consume, and I hated it. And that's even before getting into the treatment of girls and kind of the inherited homophobia from pretty much anywhere in that kind of environment. I hadn't really considered queerness at that point, but knowing that gay was supposed to be an insult still, it never hit right with me. Even then, I thought it was a kind of a crass discredit to the word. I hate that so many of us still experience this, like tacitly or overtly. I know hearing this will be reactions of like, well, you can like drama and writing and traditionally non-male clothing and still be male, and that's absolutely true. But it goes without saying that the degree of alienation trans folk experience is exacerbated hugely by the conditioning we grew up in, or reacting away from it. Maybe my self-perceptions would have been different if I'd had a different school environment. But if you don't know about queer culture, you just assume you're different, which an environment filled with a constant barrage of what you're not doing to fit in usually means wrong. There were points that I just knew instead that I had to be one of the few nice guys, that every other guy was terrible, and that I was somehow a more noble being destined for a greater future by not having had a girlfriend yet, and that somehow whoever it was going to be would be more than grateful for the way I had treated them when I was given the chance. But but that I would never impose myself to ask a woman to date me, that I had to wait and let my magnanimous humility do the work for me. Yeah, I was a baby incel for a while. So I'm glad that didn't come to fruition, because we all know how that can turn out. And, you know, I want to be clear that I'm not intimating even for a second that incels are just trans folk waiting to accept it. That's a dangerous and really damaging mindset. Regardless of whether any incels are actually trans or discover themselves to be, blanket assumptions like that don't really help anyone. It's just a period I went through because of poor societal conditioning I had and the cycling kind of ever-present toxic culture encouraged in very hyper-masculine spaces. I'm really, really super lucky to have parents and sisters who taught me how to communicate well emotionally. I think it would have been a lot harder if I wasn't able to express myself through writing or just kind of jump into my imagination. Puberty is still hard though, and there were still way too many times where I didn't talk about things and manifested them in weird kind of unhealthy ways, like dissociating after being bullied and believing that I was legitimately Fox McCloud just waiting to wake up from a coma in another world and that this was all just a dream. You can't really tell someone that and feel like you'd be taken seriously. It's not the fault of anyone who offered up help, but, you know, without wanting to victim blame, in retrospect, it was my responsibility to do something with it. But when you've never faced anything like that before, you just don't know what to do, and that's not a fault. So school sucked, by and large. Not before I jumped at the chance to be the fairy godmother in my first role on stage, you know, pink massive dress and falsetto and everything. After that was college, and my first jump into an atmosphere much more acceptably LGBT. I got to spend meaningful time with the first gay people I knew, and had a crush on at least one of them. My tutor, John Dryden, was one of the most kindest and supportive people I've ever met. And he's gay, lives very happily with his husband in Corfu. That was a hole broken in the wall to helping normalize that for me. After that, I guess it wasn't until I got into the cosplay and furry communities that began having more distinct moments of gender questioning. I didn't know the term dysphoria at the time, but one moment I remember very distinctly is when I was invited to be part of a Ruby cosplay group. That's the Rooster Teeth animation. None of the male characters particularly struck me, because I just love the strength and the personalities of the main girls. The problem I had was I didn't want to be a gender-swapped version. I wanted to be one of the girls. But if I couldn't be a girl perfectly, and back then I knew I couldn't be because of my body shape and my facial hair and a distinct lack of confidence, I decided instead to be a monster, the Beowulf. And I made a joke of it at the time that I was just better at making fursuits than props, but it was a feeling that kind of stuck with me ever since, that actually I wanted to be like them, whether it was Ruby or Yang or whoever. I wanted the chance to be a girl, or at least pass as one as effortlessly as a cis girl could. I kind of had a break from cosplay after that, where my gender feels were directed more into my fursona and learning about the trans community through the people I met in the furry fandom. It was a lot to learn. So mostly I kind of sat back and listened and shared what I could and just read others' feelings about what they were going through and how their transitions worked. It's still something intimidating and confusing to me, honestly, even though I know it's a path that I want to take and one I have just started, actually, about a month on Australia now. It's going pretty well. One of the most defining moments, I guess, in determining that I was not as cis as I thought I was when I was at the drive-thru at a Wendy's. And this isn't to do with furries, by the way. They were still offering chicken tenders at the time. If that gives you an indication as to how long ago this was, I don't really remember. But chicken tenders took a while to cook, and they were usually made to order, so I had to sit in my car by the door at the corner of the restaurant, which, thanks to them putting road cones in parking spaces opposite, left not much room for any other cars to get past. I was very, very self-conscious of this and being an obstruction. So this big white pickup pulls up behind me, and I'm thinking, oh, they probably have space, but hopefully I'll get food before I need to move. I really hope they don't sit there and honk at me. Before the driver moved a single inch, like didn't even move from his spot before giving his food, he leans out of his window and yells, "Hey lady, you're blocking the way." I could dictate a whole essay here about the different aspects of toxic masculine culture in this one interaction about entitlement and authority assumptions and view of women as obstacles, and a whole other essay about how trans folk are consistently aware of the inconvenience they're forced to be by other people simply by view of environmental and societal circumstances that aren't their choice, but you know, that's for another time, maybe. But it riled me up so much, partly because of my self-consciousness and the correct deduction that he would, in fact, be the arsehole I predicted he'd be, that I stuck my head out the window and yelled back, "Do I look like a freaking girl, mate?"
Only he didn't use freaking.
And immediately knew that I had insulted myself. I drove vengefully around the building so he could get his bloated gas crapper through and sat back in silence by the door like I was told to. I was furious with myself to have so unconsciously and blatantly sabotaged my own feelings just to make a cheap comeback at someone who didn't even take a single second to determine anything about me or my situation. Someone who ironically misgendered me almost correctly but still consciously made me an obstacle because their ego told them they needed more space for something that was already too big to reasonably fit around spaces that I was put into by Wendy's and not by choice. Which, you know, is kind of par for the course for arrogant white men and why things are so shitty for trans and gender non-conforming folk in the first place. There are a lot of reasons why that hit so hard. Partly it was just him. Partly it was knowing I was already an obstruction. Partly it was wanting to punch back at entitled old piss men with stupid huge cars and a culture of obviously obliviously toxic blowhards always having influence and power over people. But mostly it's because I was forced into pointing out my own flawed presentation, my kind of degree of being trapped, highlighted what I felt I wasn't, but wanted to have been. I kind of hated myself for what I said ever since and have a hard time kind of reconciling it. For how badly I felt I treated myself in that one moment, it also kind of weirdly validated my insecurities about what I could be. Silly thing is, I never once worried about being mistaken for a woman online before that. In my whole history at otaku boards, I was mistaken as a girl 9 times, including twice, by the same person, even after telling him otherwise. I guess it was just my custom purple font. I love that hex code. I actually found it a huge compliment at the time, but for how frustrating it was, that Wendy's parking lot was a turning point for knowing more definitively that I needed to learn more about myself and how to adequately express what I needed to discover. So here I am. Hi, trans, furry, anxious, but decided. I don't really have a segue for this next bit, so I just wanted to touch a little more about what happens when someone comes out. There are often accusations of trans trenders flying around, and they are almost entirely false flags designed to gatekeep who is and who is not allowed to express their gender. This usually falls in line with a way of thinking called transmedicalism or true scum, the idea that you must have dysphoria to be trans, which is not true, and often that you must transition completely opposite to your assigned birth gender, which is inordinately dismissive of non-binaries. Anyone who accuses you of being trans for clout has a monstrous misunderstanding of trans culture. Being trans opens you up to far more abuse, targeted harassment, and potential exile from people you've loved for years, not to mention the continual difficulty of trying to just exist when the medical, insurance, and political systems throw up roadblocks to deny you have a right to exist without extreme luck, stringent conformity, or a lot of money. Being trans is not about popularity, it's about truth. What gets misinterpreted as popularity is that people are often already connected to, or hopefully quickly find, a supportive community network that is accepting of trans folk and find a solid place to exist as part of that. The popularity is not renown, as most outsiders would see it, but being welcomed into that support network. It's very telling that if people have never had a chance to be so honest in themselves to find a community like that, somehow seeing someone else be accepted into that paints it with resentment so easily. I get that it may come out as a shock to find that someone is trans, but really it isn't about you. If you've ever valued someone as a friend or a loved one, and they're telling you this, they are usually telling you because they want you in their life. They are gifting you their confidence and trust. Enough that presenting this has often taken a build-up of weeks or months or maybe even longer than that. They have invested that much energy into preparing to open up to you. And really, unless you have a fundamental issue with how you treat people based on appearances, nothing should change. If anything does change, it should be the chance to be even more open, breaking down what's likely been an emotional barrier between you for some time, or a chance to get even more involved with their life for knowing. Oh, you're trans? Awesome, congratulations. Still up for pizza on Sunday? That's it. That's how normal it can be. I guarantee trans folk do not want your entire world to revolve around their change. They just want to be who they are, live normally, and literally the only thing you have to do to help them is not be an asshole. I'm sure some people will go on to cast aspersions about brainwashing, the trans cult that turns people trans through indoctrination. It doesn't happen like that. What happens is queer kids, queer people, trans people find spaces that allow them to express and discover themselves more openly in ways that they were always ashamed to before. The more spaces you are given to be yourself, the more you can embrace what you're scorned for outside. I mean, imagine that. When you're not having to guard yourself constantly from overheard jokes or direct abuse, when you're allowed to have conversations and ask questions and pursue feelings that until that point you didn't even know existed, that you begin to move further into authentic self-expression without limitations placed on you by fearful bigots or inherited bias. It's called education. It's called compassion. It's not brainwashing, and it's not creating predators either. Trans people of all genders are more likely to be assaulted by cis men than cis women by any trans folk. Anyone peddling anti-trans views is doing nothing but protecting their own ego and ignorance and punching down on something they refuse to educate themselves about. There are entire platforms, movements, people trying to monetize that hate and turn them into nationwide misinformation propaganda that, when it literally does not affect them whatsoever, it's sickening. And if you want to join them after seeing me in this video, your choice, your loss, your insecurity. I am going to be me for the rest of my life. I don't exist for your convenience. For myself, I'm just getting started. I'm not sure of the exact destination yet, but I know it's what I want. It's who I am, more pertinently. I have come too far, and I have learned too much about myself and my potential to be able to think otherwise. Anyway, thanks to everyone who's listened so far, and to those who have always been listening and sharing their own stories so that I could begin finding the one that I was already writing, but I wasn't even aware of. Stay strong. I love you.